Hello friends, Chris here with ISK Recording. Welcome to Lesson 22, the audio interface. My goal for this video is not to spoon feed you which audio interface I think you should get. No, I'm going to teach you about what an audio interface is, what it does, and what some of the common features are that you can find in them. And then you can do your own research as to which audio interface suits your needs the best. So what is the audio interface? Well, it's a hub that routes all of your audio in and out of the computer. Now, it only routes audio in and out of the computer digitally. It doesn't route any analog audio to and from the computer because the computer can't recognize analog audio. It only recognizes zeros and ones, and that's digital audio. Quite often, when we're recording multiple channels at the same time. For instance, the drum kit that's right there, I've got, I think, like 14 microphones on that kit. So it's the job of the audio interface to receive all 14 of those channels and send them off into the computer where they can get worked on in the DAW. Now, since the audio interface only sends digital information to and from the DAW, it needs to receive the audio signal as either already digital information, so that could be the digital inputs of an audio interface, or as an analog signal and convert it to digital. So most interfaces will have built-in converters. And that's one of the core components of an audio interface. The other core component is the preamps. See, when you plug a microphone into your audio interface, the signal coming from the microphone is really weak and it needs to be boosted before going to the converters. So that's the role of the preamp. It's a little amplifier and you've got a gain knob and you want to boost it to the optimal level so that you get a lower noise floor. Now, your audio interface needs to connect to the computer somehow to send that information back and forth. The most common is probably USB or USB 3, but there's also interfaces that use FireWire, Thunderbolt, and Ethernet. There's no difference in sound quality between the different connection types. There's only a difference in speed. And what the speed affects is how many channels you can record simultaneously. So I don't really know the specs, but even your most basic USB 2.0 connection is capable of a pretty high channel count without interruption. The two biggest differences between all the interfaces on the market are A, the channel count, and B, the quality. So with channel count, that's how many channels it's capable of streaming in and out of the computer simultaneously. And on the interface itself, that channel count can be implemented as digital inputs and outputs and analog inputs and outputs. And there's a variety of different types of digital and analog inputs and outputs, and for this video I'm just going to assume that you know them because I already covered that in lesson 15. So you might be wondering, if I'm only recording one channel of audio, do I even need an interface, or can I just use a USB mic or plug my mic directly into the computer? And the answer is, of course, it depends. You see, one of the big advantages of using an audio interface as opposed to just plugging right into the computer is the audio interface will provide what's called zero latency monitoring. When the audio goes into your computer and into your DAW, the DAW needs a little bit of time to process that audio and then send it back out. Now we're talking milliseconds, sometimes even up to like half a second. But that little bit of a delay is very distracting if you're listening to yourself in a headphone mix. So for instance, if you're playing guitar and you're plugged into the computer and you're listening back in headphones, if there's a tiny little bit of a delay, then when you strike those notes, you hear it like just an instant later, and it's very disruptive to the playing. Same with singing. If you don't hear yourself in the exact instantaneous time that you sing the note, it just sounds off. You wouldn't be able to perform. So an audio interface will take that incoming signal and split it, send it into the DAW, but also route it straight back into the headphone mix, and the signal that goes into your headphone mix never went through the DAW, so it doesn't have any latency. Now, one thing I will point out though, when they call it zero latency monitoring, it's not really truly zero latency. There's a tiny little bit of latency as the signal goes into the converters and then back out through the converters. The interface itself doesn't cause any latency, but the conversion process does. It's usually less than like 5 milliseconds and it's not really noticeable, but I just wanted to point out that there is in fact a tiny little bit of latency. So let's take a look at the layout of a very basic two-channel recording interface. You've got your two inputs, which go into preamps. From the preamps, it goes to the converters. From the converters, it goes into the computer. And then for outputs, it's got two line outputs to feed your monitors and a headphone output. This is a pretty common design, and there's a lot of interfaces on the market that follow exactly this. And really, for a lot of recordings, this is all you need. So the difference between all the different ones that follow the same layout would be the sound quality. So they'll have different preamps and different converters, but really the one part that makes the biggest difference is the preamps. The more expensive ones, such as the Apogee Duet, will presumably have better preamps. And the Apogee Duet actually does have really good preamps in it. Another feature that some interfaces have is the ability to process DSP, DSP stands for Digital Signal Processing. And basically, that's having hardware in the interface that processes audio, and in your computer, you'll have software to control it. So within the computer, you'll be able to bring up a window that controls the interface, and you'll be able to put in certain plugins or effects such as reverb, compression, EQ. Not all interfaces have this, only some. And some interfaces will still have their own routing software. So when you plug the interface in, you download the drivers and the software, and then you'd be able to control certain routing, send input channel 1, output channel 3 if you wanted to. And you would also control your zero latency monitoring. Oh, and by the way, zero latency monitoring is also called direct monitoring. And you'd also be able to control your direct monitoring through that software. And some interfaces don't have any software routing capabilities. They just go straight into your DAW, and they'll have your direct monitoring controls as physical knobs on the front panel of the interface itself. Another feature most interfaces will have is called high Z inputs. High Z stands for high impedance, and the output of a guitar is high impedance. And if you're recording an electric guitar DI, that means you're recording an electric guitar direct inject, you're plugging straight from the guitar into the interface, you need a high Z input. If you don't have the DI input right on your interface, that's no problem. You can still record the guitar DI, but you need to purchase a separate DI box that converts the guitar input into an XLR output, and then that gets plugged into the preamp. So let's just take a quick look at some of the interfaces on the market. Here's a Behringer UMC202. This is a similar design to what I talked about earlier. It's got two inputs. It's got your monitor outputs and your headphone outputs. And for direct monitoring, it's got physical hardware knobs on the unit itself. Now here's the Behringer UMC404. It's almost identical to the UMC202, except the UMC202 is only capable of two channels in, two channels out simultaneously, and the 404 is capable of four channels in and four channels out simultaneously. And also on the UMC404, the direct monitoring controls are on the front panel of the interface itself. Now the UMC404 is more expensive than the UMC202, so is it better quality? And the answer is no. It is the exact same quality. It uses all the same hardware, all the same components. The only difference is that it's capable of a higher channel count. And then as you get into interfaces that have even higher channel count, you start to get more variety of the different analog inputs and the different digital inputs. For instance, let's take a look at the Focusrite 18i20. You've got 8 analog inputs, which can be XLR for microphone level or quarter inch for a line level input. And you've got 8 channels of digital in and out on ADAT. Here's another example of a very basic audio interface. It's the Metric Halo Leo 8. Leo stands for line in out. That's it. It's got 8 analog inputs, 8 analog outputs. It does not come with any built-in preamps unless you purchase them as a separate add-on. So this is for studios that have their own external preamps that they want to use. So they would just plug the output from the preamp into the line input of the interface. This interface also has 8 channels of digital audio in and out through ABS-EBU protocol. So as it is, it's capable of 16 channels in and 16 channels out simultaneously, plus the headphone output, I guess. So 18 channels out technically if you count the stereo left and right there. And another example I'd like to show you is the Antelope Orion 32, which provides 32 analog inputs and 32 analog outputs, plus an additional 32 digital inputs and outputs. So it's capable of routing 64 channels in and out of the computer simultaneously. So you might be wondering, well, what in the world does anybody need that many inputs and outputs for? Well, all those inputs are for recording either multiple people at the same time, or for instance, a drum kit, like that drum kit there, I've got like 14 microphones on it. Or maybe both, the drum kit and a whole bunch of people at the same time. Or if you're recording an orchestra and you want to have spot mics on all the different sections and you want to have room mics as well. Or maybe you're just recording a piano and you want to use 32 microphones to capture it. That's actually not unheard of. And for the outputs, there's a few different uses. One is if you're recording a full rock band, everybody needs to have their own monitor set. One monitor set, you need a stereo left and right. So that takes up 2 channels. So let's say you're recording 5 people. Each person needs their own headphone monitor. That's 10 channels of audio that needs to go out to the various artists. Plus the recording engineer needs a couple of channels so that they can listen to it too. And another use for having lots of outputs is for analog summing, mixing out of the box. What some high-end studios do is they do their mixes on a physical mixing board. Sometimes you'll see like pictures of studios and they'll have this giant mixing desk. That's what it's for. So when you're mixing a song, let's say your song has 24 tracks in it. There's 24 parts. So what they're doing is they play each track out its own output of the interface, and that gets plugged into its own channel on the mixing board, and they mix it in the analog domain on the mixing board, and the stereo output of the mixing board gets recorded back into the computer. In my studio, I have 48 outputs, and I actually use all 48 of them. I use 28 channels for my analog summing, and then 16 channels for my monitoring, because I've got a bunch of monitoring stations around the studio for artists to come in. It's pretty much plug and play. I could have like a six-piece band come in, plug in, put their headphones on, and control their own mix right there. So each mix station has its own set that gets two channels of audio from the interface routed to it. And then I use two outputs for my main monitors, and I have another two outputs that are just auxiliary outputs that I use for reamping or if I need an output for anything. So like I said earlier, one of the biggest differences between the different interfaces is their quality. For instance, if you have two different interfaces that are capable of the same channel count, but they're priced differently, presumably the more expensive one should give better sound quality than the lower cost one. But how much better quality is it really? And honestly, that depends on the rest of your studio setup if you'd even be able to hear the difference in sound quality, because a chain is only as strong as its weakest link. But just to show you what these modern interfaces are capable of, I did a recording with the Behringer UMC404. This is the lowest cost 4-channel interface you can get. So if you want to see what kind of quality this interface can achieve, I've got another video demonstrating that. It's called "You Don't Need Expensive Recording Equipment. Check out this full band recording." I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, please give a high five to that like button down there, thumbs up. Also, if you're into audio recording, I'm putting an entire structured audio engineering course right here on YouTube. So hit subscribe and you'll get all that content for free. Gotta love it. Have a great day. I'll see you in the next video.